I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. Stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord.
Hey, good morning. Welcome to Twickenham. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. If you're a guest this morning, we are honored that you've chosen to be with us. I hope you had a great Thanksgiving. If you're in town visiting family, we'll have counseling services after our worship this morning to help you with that. If you're traveling, we hope you stay safe. If you're from our community, we're really glad you're here. Thanks for coming out to be with us today. My name is Jody. I'm a preacher here, and just thrilled to have you. Glad you came out. I think this season of the year can be kind of tough, beginning, you know, around Thanksgiving and running through Christmas and the New Year. Kind of hard time for some of us because our lives kind of match the weather out there right now, sort of gray and rainy and blah. And yet you've got all of these lights and this music and kind of mismatched. We're going to talk about that a little bit today, about finding hope in the middle of what can sometimes be a difficult season. I want to thank Janet for didn't she just do a great job? Can you give her a hand for the beautiful work she's done here. Thank you, Janet. There's a card on the back of the seat in front of you. You can fill that out, and you can place that in the collection plate a little bit later on. If you have a prayer request, you can indicate that on the card. Tomorrow morning, the staff will be praying over that. That'll be passed on to our elders. If you want everybody to pray about it, then we will. But if you indicate private, we'll only keep it with our staff and elders. But go ahead and fill one of those out. If you're a guest, we'd love to have a record of you having been with us today. We're not going to drop in on you unannounced. We're not going to sell your information unless somebody pays us a lot of money. And then we will send you a letter, though, that just says thanks for coming out to be with us today. We're glad you're here. Thank you. Want to begin our service in a really special way. Can I get Adam and Christy to come on up? An offering, kind of a makeup. We started kind of our makeup month, and you came through really, really solidly, $47,300. So really great response. Some of you weren't here able to be a part of that, so we'll be taking makeup contributions for the rest of the month. But we're going to do our offering right now. If you want to realize that this is a time, too, of worship where we surrender to God, and we say to God, we trust you more than we trust whatever we put in the plate. We believe you can take care of our needs more than anything else in the world. Let's sing, and as we give, let's worship.
My life's in you, my strength's in you, my hope's in you, it's in you.
My life is in you, Lord, my strength is in you, Lord, my hope is in you, Lord, in you. Is in you, Lord, my hope. Is in you, Lord, in you, it's in you. I will praise you with all of my life. I will praise you with all of my strength. With all
is in you, Lord, my strength is in you, Lord, my hope is in you, Lord, in you. Praise you with all of my life.
Let's stand.
I will praise you with all of my strength, with all of my life, with all of my strength. All of my hope is in you. My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. In you. Jesus, a comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. For all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Jesus, a hope of the nations. Jesus, a comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains. You rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope living for all who will.
People walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. God, you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer.
on wings like eagles.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary.
As we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Amen. And you can turn in your Bibles to Lamentations chapter 3. Lamentations chapter 3. That's a hard book to find because it's just let your Bible open to the middle and then turn right. A couple of pages over Lamentations chapter 3. Quick program note, Wednesday night we start dessert and Devo, right? Dessert, we got so many, I've been here 6 months and I still don't know all the acronyms, okay? Devo, dinner, dessert and Devo. Dessert and Devo on Wednesday nights starting this Wednesday. So is that, what time is that? 6:30. And we'll have coffee and desserts and some other things. And I'm going to do a thing called Ghosts Around the Manger. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's a little bit experimental. Okay? So we'll see how it goes. But if you're interested in seeing experiments and how they turn out, you might want to come. We're going to talk about some of the people in Matthew chapter 1. The first 14 or so verses in Matthew are the most boring in the Bible. Many a commitment to read through the New Testament has been shipwrecked on the shores of Matthew chapter 1. So we'll talk about some of those odd characters in that first part of Matthew chapter 1 on Wednesday nights. They are in the lineage of Jesus, and there's a reason why. So that'll be Wednesday night at 6:30. The year 2015 is ending the same way it began, pretty much, which is not to say well, which is to say not well, rather. In January, the offices of the French satirical magazine Charlie Hebdo were attacked by Muslim terrorists. 12 were killed. And then 3 weeks ago, Paris was the target again. And this time, the death toll was 130. In March of this year, a German jetliner with 150 passengers crashed in the French Alps, killing everyone on board. Investigators determined that the co-pilot deliberately drove the plane into the ground, but they still don't know why. In that same month, March 2015, Malaysian Airlines Flight 370 disappeared over the South China Sea. 12 crew members, 227 passengers from 15 different nations. Debris has been found, but nobody yet knows what happened exactly. In April, Baltimore erupted into violence after Freddie Gray died in police custody. Last week, Chicago took its turn. In May of this year, so much rain fell in Texas that if it had been evenly distributed across the state, border to border, it would have covered the state in 8 inches of water. Almost 30 people died in the flooding. In June, a man walked into a church in Charleston on a Wednesday night, sat down, listened to their Bible study, and then he got up and shot him, killed 9 people. The U.S. Office of Personnel Management revealed in July that their original estimate of the number of Americans whose personal data had been compromised by hackers was off by 4 million. The revised number affected by multiple hacks, probably the Chinese, was over 22 million. That included Social Security numbers and other sensitive information, and that included some people in this room. In August, 3,000 refugees a day were crossing the Balkans into Western Europe. Germany estimated that by the end of 2015, 800,000 migrants would seek asylum just in their country. Recent reports indicate that estimate was low. Wildfires raged in California in September, burning hundreds of thousands of acres, destroying hundreds of homes and businesses, displacing thousands of In October, the U.S. Department of Labor reported that the labor participation rate, the percentage of Americans involved in the labor force, the labor participation rate for the previous month fell to 62.4%, the lowest since October 1977. That's when I graduated from high school. The total labor force in 2015 hit a 2015 low, losing another 350,000 people. There was some good news in the October report, though. The duration of unemployment dropped an average of 26.3 weeks in the year. That was the good news, that people were only unemployed for half the year. Since the November jobs report was better than anybody thought it would be, then the Federal Reserve decided that it would consider raising interest rates, which would be good news for a handful, bad news for most. I decided to stop there with the monthly report of bad things that happened in 2015. I think that makes the point. You could put your hope in technology, but for as often as technology helps, somebody is using it to hack us or to replace us. And basically, technology just helps us sin more efficiently. You could put your hope in government, and some people do. Maybe it's ours, maybe it's somebody else's. But at the very best, what you're going to get is inefficiency, and at the worst, you're going to get evil. And even after all of the regulations that followed the banking scandals of the early 2000s, the financial system still feels rigged and risky. Jobs are scarce. Many Americans feel like strangers in their own country, and the country itself seems more divided than ever. These large-scale headline losses are not the only thing that we experience, though. They were accompanied by millions of small, unpublicized, but very personal devastations. A doctor opens his tablet to punch in the code for a diagnosis, and as he looks up the number for the diagnosis, he wonders how he's going to translate this bad news to the patient and her family. A judge sits at her desk, her shoulders slumps, and she sighs just before she signs her name to another divorce document. A family business turns the key to lock the door for the last time on its store. A mid-sized company downsizes to small. A single mom hesitates before opening the mailbox, certain that there are going to be more bills than money. A troubled 15-year-old writes a desperate farewell. A husband and father thinks about praying, but doesn't. Theologian Walter Brueggemann wrote, "We live in a culture defined by loss. That loss touches everything and everyone. It includes the failure of the social fabric, the failure of intellectual certitudes, the failure of organizational structures, the failure of worldwide economic viability." Look at the words across the front of this stage. In a world so apparently defined by tragedy, loss, and failure, do the words hope, peace, joy, and love have any ring of truth or possibility? We say we believe, but there is so much evidence I mean, do these words ring of truth, or do they sound like so much religious denial in the face of overwhelming evidence that there is little to believe in, less to look forward to, and nothing that can be done? Among the treasures we have lost, our innocence, our security, our confidence in the future, there is one precious jewel that must be recovered: memory. Without memory, we're like people with amnesia, people who have forgotten that others have been here before and that they survived. If we remembered their survival, we could read their records to learn how people who were staggered by loss regain their footing. The good news is there was such a people. They did survive. There is a record, and it is an honest record. It is filled with stories of barrenness and grief and doubt and rage, but it is as hopeful a record as it is honest, because the barrenness gives way to birth. The grief gives way to peace. The doubt is replaced by certainty. The rage is satisfied by justice. And when we read these stories and embrace them, then we can believe in hope and joy and peace and love. I want you to listen to these old words from a book whose very title sounds relevant for our times, Lamentations chapter 3. Listen to verses 18, 19, and 20. My splendor is gone, and all that I had hoped from the Lord. I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Okay, if that's where Lamentations ended, if Jeremiah put a period at the end of verse 20 and then wrote the end, if the book of Lamentations ended there, all we could say is that somebody somewhere at least knew what it was like to live in an unhinged world. But the painful honesty of verses 18 through 20 is followed by these words, verses 21 through 26. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, because his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to those who seek him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. How can someone who so eloquently described his struggle with despair pen words so equally full of confidence? That would be a good thing for us to know. Because if the prophet Jeremiah was able to see light shining in the darkness, maybe we can too. The difference between unrecoverable desolation and unintimidated confidence in the future is hope. We'll talk about how to find that hope in just a bit. But first, we need to be sure we know what hope is and what hope is not. Hope is not optimism, even though I dearly love optimists. Optimists tend to live longer than pessimists. They accomplish more than pessimists. They're a lot more fun to be around. A pessimist can hardly wait for the future so that he can look back on the past with regret. His favorite phrase is, "I told you so." Optimists can hardly wait for the future because they just know it's going to be so much better than today. And their favorite phrase is, "I told you so." Kind of like the student who was seen riding a bicycle across a university campus. He was wearing a t-shirt. The t-shirt said, "Studying to be a doctor." On the back of his bicycle was a tag. The tag read, "Studying to be a Mercedes." Optimists just handle everything better than pessimists. They handle failure better than pessimists. I heard this story about this fifth grader named Michael. And Michael decided he was going to run for class president. And so he had his mom and dad printed up these little buttons that they handed out. And Michael for class president is what it read. And he had to go to the pediatrician during the campaign. And when he went to the pediatrician, the doctor noticed the button on his lapel. And he said, "Well, Michael, I ran for class president when I was your age too, but I lost." So a couple of days later, Michael called his mom with the election results, and this was Michael's optimistic take on things. He said, "Mom, great news. It looks like I'm going to be a doctor." Optimism is awesome. It's an awesome way to live. But it is not the same thing as hope. Optimists survey the circumstances and they find the positive. Hope, on the other hand, doesn't take its cue from the circumstances. In fact, there's an odd calculus involved with hope. The greater the pain, the more desperate things are, the stronger, more confident hope becomes. Look in Romans chapter 5, in verses 3 through 5, Paul talks about this. Romans is over in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans chapter 5. Paul talks about this concept about how hope doesn't worry about its circumstances. Here's what Paul says. "Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings." When was the last time you saw a phrase or heard a phrase? "We celebrate our suffering." Why? "Because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope doesn't put us to shame," or some of your versions will say disappoint us, "because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit whom He has given us." Hope isn't worried about the circumstances. Optimists look at the circumstances and find something good. Hope looks at the worst of circumstances and doesn't worry about them. Why? Why does hope not put us to shame? Why does hope not disappoint? Paul says, because God. Optimism can be disappointed by unanticipated failure or loss. Positive thinking can be swallowed up by the stunning onslaught of reality. Wishes do not always come true, but hope does not disappoint because God. Which is exactly why Jeremiah in Lamentations was able to find hope in his dismal circumstance. Chapter 3, it's what he said, "Yet this I call to mind, therefore I have hope." Same thing Paul said, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed." Jeremiah's confidence in the future had nothing to do with optimism. If you were to rank the characters of the Bible in order of their positive spirit and optimistic outlook, Jeremiah would be dead last. He was by far the most pessimistic prophet to ever bend Israel's ear. He's called the weeping prophet. If he ever got invited to a party, it would have been his last. The lights dimmed when Jeremiah walked into the room. He was the Eeyore of the Old Testament. He's the one prophet that Joel Osteen never quotes. And yet when Jeremiah talks about the future, he sounds like a commissioned sales guy. Why? His hope was in God. Okay, so how do you do that? I mean, if that's how you have awful circumstances and still have confidence about the future, how do you do that? How do you generate hope that God will do something awesome out of all this awful? Memory. Memory. Hope, that confident expectation that the future will be better, is based on remembering God's faithful action in the past. By reaching into the past, we find assurances that the future will not be destroyed by the present. Because if God was with His people, He will be with His people. You see, memory is not just about what's behind you. It's also about what is ahead of you. Memory works in both directions. Let me show you one example of somebody that was rescued from despair by remembering the past. We're talking about the fact that hope comes from remembering what God has done for us in the past. Look in 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. The Apostle Paul, who wrote this letter to a young protege named Timothy, is under house arrest, and he's writing what may well be his last letter, okay? So here's how he kind of describes his circumstances as he writes this letter to Timothy. Do your best to come to me quickly, because Demas, because he loved this world, has deserted me and has gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia, Titus to Dalmatia. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you because he's helpful to me in my ministry. I sent Tychicus to Ephesus. When you come, bring the cloak that I left with Carpus at Troas, and my scrolls, especially the parchments. Alexander the metal worker did me a great deal of harm. Metal workers never liked apostles, because metal workers made idols and apostles taught people not to buy them. So Alexander was mad at Paul, did him a great deal of harm. The Lord will repay him for what he has done. You too should be on your guard against him, because he strongly opposed our message. At my first defense, no one came to my support, but everybody deserted me. May it not be held against them. So here's the situation. Paul is under house arrest. He's awaiting trial. It's probably going to be a guilty verdict, and it's probably going to mean death. He has been deserted by people he thought he could trust. Demas loved the world and deserted Paul. He is alone. Everybody has either deserted him or they're carrying out the mission in other places. His enemies have done a lot of damage to him. Nobody showed up at his preliminary hearing to support him, and winter is coming. He tells Timothy, bring the cloak I left with Carpus. I'm cold. Paul sounds a lot like Jeremiah. Everything is rotten, horrible, no good, very bad. Then he says this. Now pay attention to the tenses of the verbs, okay? But the Lord stood at my side and gave me strength, so that through me the message might be fully proclaimed and all the Gentiles might hear it, and I was delivered from the lion's mouth. Notice all those verbs are in the past tense. Now listen to verse 18. The Lord will rescue me from every evil attack, and will bring me safely to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. By remembering what had happened, how the Lord had been there for him in the past, Paul was able to look forward to the future with confident hope that he was going to be okay, because God was going to be with him then, just as God had been with him in the past. His circumstances stink, but he remembers how the Lord stood at his side, how the Lord gave him strength, how he was delivered. And based on his memory of what God had done, he could face his future with hope. Hope for the future comes from remembering God's faithfulness in the past. Hope grows out of memory. Okay? That's what I want you to remember. Hope grows out of memory. So here's the hard part. Christmas can seem like a grand contradiction to a lot of us. Everything is lit up and decked out. But for some of us, there are just not enough lights in the world to brighten the darkness we're living in. Everywhere we go, we hear all this joyful music, but it feels like a mismatched soundtrack for the life we're living. It's like somebody queued up calliope music for a funeral. It feels inappropriate. We feel completely out of sync with the season. That's understandable. There are a lot of people in this room who can remember Christmases when there was more pain than praise, when we felt more dejected than joyful. That's why we need to remember the story behind all the lights and colors and music. God came to a dark and broken world, a world that had all but forgotten how to sing or shine or celebrate. He came not as a warrior bent on conquest, but in the blessed disguise of a child. He came to bring peace and love and joy. He came to bring hope. In the catacombs of ancient Rome, Archaeologists have discovered a number of early Christian symbols. One of them is the fish. That's been a Christian symbol for centuries. One is the shepherd. That makes sense. The Lord is my shepherd. And then they discovered another common symbol on the walls of these catacombs, an anchor, which is odd because these are mainland Christians. Why would they choose an anchor as a symbol for faith? Maybe they'd read Hebrews 6:19. But we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. The catacombs were where Christians hid from Roman persecution and where they buried their dead. It's odd, isn't it, that a symbol of a firm and secure hope would exist in a place of hiding and fear and death. Well, not when you remember that their hope in the face of persecution and death rested on the memory of a manger birth, a sinless life, an empty tomb, a risen Savior, and a coming King. Do you remember what Jesus said when he instituted the Lord's Supper? He said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Why? Was that for him? Was that so he would not be forgotten? I don't think so. I think that was for us. I think he said that not so that he would not be forgotten, but so that we would not forget. Author Paul Oster said, "Memory is the space in which a thing happens for the second time." When we remember the manger, he is born again in us. And when we remember the cross, we are born again in him. We're going to sing, and then we're going to pray and share our Lord's Supper together. Let's remember what he did for us.
Bread of life, dear living water, lover of my soul. In my weakness, be my strength to reach the final goal. Lamb of God, dear hope of glory, Savior crucified. By your blood I am redeemed, my debt now satisfied.
God. And as God, you created us to share the glory you had with us, making us in your own image. As God, you delivered your people from Egypt, from bondage. As God, you continued to pursue your people even when backs were turned on you. As God, you came to us in utter darkness and complete failure. You became one of us. And you walked among us, and you taught us, and you loved us, and you died for us. And you live for us now. Father, we have hope because you are God. you have never failed us, and you're not going to start now. We thank you that we have hope, and we remember all that you have done for us and all that you are, and that is what our hope is in, and that is what we share now in this meal. In Jesus' name, amen.
My only hope is you,
Jesus. My only hope is you.
From early in the morning till late at night,
my only hope is you.
Yes, my only hope is you,
Jesus. My only hope.
My hope is you,
from early in the morning
until late at night.
My only hope is you,
from early in the morning
till late at night. My only hope is you.
Let's continue. God, we celebrate your goodness. We celebrate your love. We celebrate that you once came to be with us. And because you came then, we have hope that you will come again. And at this time, you'll take us with you. And we rejoice in that. And we take this bread and this cup. And we're so thankful for it and the remembrance we have in it. We love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Teach my soul to rise to you when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
Wasn't it good to be here today?
Yeah.
It's okay. You can say it. It's all right. It was good to be here. Jody, thank you for a great message. Really do appreciate it. A lot of good things happening. A lot of things coming up that you need to know about. This coming week, we have two showers. We don't normally do this, but do two things that I think you'll understand from earlier. We have two coming up this week. There's a wedding shower for Drew Herring and Nina Towle next Sunday. They're registered at Amazon, and it's under Andrew Herring. And then we will also have a baby shower next week for the Barneys, and that'll be down the hall in S206. They are registered at Target and Babies R Us. So keep those two showers in mind coming up this week. Women's Ministry has a Christmas party coming up. They are hosting a Jingle and Mingle Christmas party. No idea what that means, but it sounds like loads of fun. So make your plans to be there on Tuesday night, December the 8th. Dinner is served. You need to RSVP at ladies@twickenham.org or call the church office tomorrow. Help! We're in need of a Wednesday night teacher for the 4th and 5th grade class. Otherwise, they just roam the halls and tear the place up, okay? Please, if you could help us, we need a Wednesday night teacher. We need it now. Check with Amy, and as always, we need more nursery workers. Contact Amy Smith or call the office. TCM Advent Wreaths, if you'd like to purchase an Advent Wreath kit, they're $12. You can make your order through Amy again to enjoy the Advent season with your family. As we've already mentioned, Wednesday night classes in December are Dessert and Devo, taught by Jody, and that'll be a great time together for those Wednesdays in December. As always, we have purchasing poinsettias to decorate the auditorium with, and if you would like to purchase one in memory of or in honor of a loved one, you can sign up in the adult ed lobby, and they will be used, again, to decorate in here for our upcoming services for the rest of the month. You can also take that home after our Christmas service on the 20th. And as always, we are sending gift cards to the children of Child Haven in Coleman, Alabama. You can pick a bear up in any of the main lobbies. They're hanging from strings in here. Take that, sign the attached card, and return it with cash or a check for $25, and we will give those to the kids at Child Haven. Hey, I hope you had a great Thanksgiving. I hope you have a great week, and I hope that you are filled with thank you. Let's stand together. We're going to sing one more time, and then Eric will close us in prayer.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint. You won't grow. God, the everlasting God, you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, you comfort those in need, you lift us up on wings like eagles.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
Let's pray. Oh, Sovereign Father, we come to you giving you all praise, honor, and glory. We love you so much. We humbly come before your throne. And Father, we pray that we could display the hope that you have given us. And Father, we just echo your words from your servant Paul. We know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to this present time. Not only so, but we ourselves have the first fruits of the Spirit grown inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoptions as sons, the redemption of our bodies, for in this hope we were saved. And Father, in our weakness, we know the Spirit helps us. We do not know what to pray for, but your Spirit will intercede for us, God. We pray that you would give us the strength to walk by faith, not by sight. We pray that you give us the courage to listen to your Spirit inside of us. And God, help us to rid ourselves of the sin through the power of your Son, Jesus. God, we pray that you would help us to be the salt and the light of the world. God, as the world around us is definitely struggling and in constant tension, help us to always display and to teach and to live out the anchor of hope that comes through your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.